see, the forest department is angry with this law, not for the grand reasons of environment and wildlife that they give, but because they have lauded it over the tribals for decades, and they don't want a law which empowers the adivasis. They don't like it, and it takes away their power to harass the tribals. So what is happening now is that the forest department is doing its worst to curtail the scope of this act, and the government by its inaction is cooperating in the sense. When such a law is made, the government is supposed to explain to the people what rights have been given to them. That is not being done. And this is a law which is very significant in the sense that the people are judges of their own rights. It is not a case where a court judges their rights, or a revenue official judges their rights, or a forest settlement officer judges their rights. The people judge their own rights. The people as a collectivity are judges of their individual as well as collective rights. This message has not gone to the people anywhere. They are given the impression that the government in its benevolence is giving pattas also for forest land that they are cultivating, and maybe they are happy about it, but that they are the judges, and the forest department no longer has authority to decide things. Forest department is only a party in the proceedings. This is a fact which is not told to them, and this is a case, a law where the people, the Gram Sabha, will elect a forest rights committee which will prepare, either prepare claims or receive claims, prepare a report on those claims. The Gram Sabha as a judge will sit and decide the claims, and forest department gets notice in the proceedings. It's a party, it's a respondent in the proceedings. Unfortunately, what is happening is, apart from not telling the people that this is the nature of this law, the forest department is entering at the very stage of preparing the claims or receiving the claims. The forest department personnel are accompanying the forest rights committee of the villages. They are accompanying them, they are trying to dictate what land should be included, what rights should be included, and so on. And they are doing two things. One is they are hiding the fact that this act gives not only right to land, but a number of rights. A number of rights to enjoy forest produce, the forest, the natural wealth of the forest, not only land. That this is being given by this act is not something not told to the people. And the forest department is given the impression that this is an act which is concerned only about the land rights. Secondly, the forest department is trying to give the impression that you get a right to land only if you are continuously cultivating it till today, which is not what the act says. Act does not even require that the person must be in possession, cultivation till 13 December 2005. It only says that prior to that date, the person must have enjoyed the right. But the impression being given by the forest department is that you must have been in continuous cultivation till today. For various reasons, people may have not be cultivating a patch of land, so they are excluding that land in preparing or accepting the claim. By the forest department personnel accompanying the forest rights committee, they want to restrict the scope of this law so that the power they have lost over the adivasis will be lost as little as possible. This is what is happening, and unfortunately the rest of the administration is going along with them. So this is something which has to be corrected and entered even tribal villages where faction kind of an attitude is there. You pick up your person in the forest rights committee and so on, which again could be set right by a proper movement if it is there. This lack is something that is being felt, and ultimately, in fact, the you said 10 to 12 lakh hectares. I don't think the government of Andhra Pradesh said so. They said 2.28 lakh acres is what they said in the...
It was the paper statement that they will be distributing 10 lakh acres.
10 lakh acres.
It's not necessarily under FRA. I mean, generally said...
After all, Chief Minister or government of Andhra Pradesh has no right to distribute forest land except under the Forest Rights Act. They have no power without the consent of the central government. And the initial statement given by the government of Andhra Pradesh was that we have identified 2.28. This was before any forest rights committee was constituted, any claims were received or processed. How does the government of Andhra Pradesh say we are going to distribute 2.28 lakh acres? Again, they want to make it seem as if it's not a case where people are deciding their own rights, but government is deciding. That message has to go through. That is one objectionable thing. Second is, today they said 2.28 lakh acres. 10 years ago, they filed a counter affidavit in the High Court in a certain context where they said 5 lakh acres of forest land is being enjoyed by tribals with the support of Naxalites. If that was 10 years ago, how can today you say it's only 2.28 lakh acres? And how can you say precisely with the decimal how many acres you are going to distribute? That means that you have decided that you will decide how much will go to them, and you will manipulate things in such a manner by pushing the forest department into the process of receiving and verifying claims and achieve this. That's what is most objectionable, but unfortunately, the ground level strong people's organizations are not placed everywhere. Some places they are there, but only in a few places. Ignored by the law of tribes. Mr. B.D. Sharma, in his 29th report to the president, pointed out this fact that is now reflected. It's a long story, a long struggle. As for the act itself, I think it is good, but there's some difficulty with the procedures. That, as I said, the Gram Sabha as a collectivity basically decides the rights, both collective and individual. and the document on the basis of which the enquiry takes place is also prepared by the people of the village, that is fine. But the difficulty is that this decision taken by the Gram Sabha is not implemented immediately. It goes, it's not a case of appeal. Even before anybody files an appeal, it goes before the higher authority. And the higher authority consists of a forest official, a revenue official, and middle tier representatives of the people in the panchayatal system who will be in a minority. And they may not be honest people also, because they could be ruling party people. Even that is not fine. It again goes to the second tier of without anybody filing an appeal, it automatically goes there. Again, you have the district collector, the district level forest official, and the Jilla Parishad member of these villages who will be in a minority and who may very well be corrupt people. So that process is a little disturbing. So we would have liked, okay, you have an appeal. I don't see why the forest department, which is a party to the proceedings, should also sit in the, as an appellate authority there. Appellate authority, you have the court. So let the village decide, forest department, revenue department being heard as party, as respondents. Let the decision be implemented subject to appeal. Let the appeal go to the district court, the judicial court, not to the revenue and forest officials sitting along with some middle tier, higher tier representatives of the people who will be in a minority, who may very well not be fair-minded people. That's the defect, is one thing. Second thing is the constitution of Gram Sabha, its definition is problematic. This is there in PESA also. It's a very complex issue that when you have a village where there are both tribals and non-tribals and different tribal communities, how do you define it? I think ideally it would be if a community, extent of community is made the Gram Sabha, that would be ideal, but ideal. But then how to work it out in practice is a little problematic. Subject to this, it's a good law. It's a good law, a very desirable piece of legislation.
In our observation in coastal Andhra and also here, only the individual claims are coming. No communal claim, no the community claim.
As a matter of fact, more precisely, only claims to land are coming forward, not other claims which are generally collective in nature. Yeah. Partly because land is so important, people are hungry to have land rights. Partly because that impression has been given that is only about land rights. And partly because other rights, the forest department has not interfered very much in the recent past. So people don't even know that it is illegal. So for instance, you are allowed to take a dry piece of timber, but you can't cut a tree. You can graze cattle, but you can't graze goats, because goats will eat up the nursery of the forest department. And if some plant in a nursery is gone, he will blame your goat. And if you are carrying a log, he will say it's not a dry log, it's you have chopped a tree. This problem has been there. But then people don't regard it as so serious as the lack of access to land. But this is one thing that we have been trying to educate people wherever we have gone, as we did today also, that you have all these rights. Any use that you have had of nature in forest, of all types, is protected by this law, and you constitute your own forest rights committees, prepare your claim. Here the forest department, that's all, you are the judge. That the people are the judge is a message which has to go strongly to them, which has not gone strongly. By the government repeatedly saying, I am going to give pata. Who are you to give patas? You have recognized the fact that the tribal right precedes you. It precedes you in historical time. That is, the law has recognized. But you, administrator doesn't recognize, the chief minister doesn't recognize. That's the problem.
Especially about Chinchur, sir.
That's what Chinchur is concerned. One thing is that the point you raised just now is more important in their case, because many of them are not cultivators. The Chinchus very recently took to cultivation. They were a food gathering community. They are only recently getting converted to a food producing community. For them, the food gathering type of rights and all that goes with it, fishing in the forest, gathering twigs by walking along a forest path, grazing cattle in forest land, and of course minor forest produce, non-timber forest produce, all the important rights. So an emphasis on the non-land rights is much more important in the case of Chinchus than, for instance, in the case of the Koyas or the Gonds in coastal Andhra or Adilabad.